I think that we are live. We're good to go. Hey, we're guys, live, what is live. Going on? So this is Rob over at Red or Blue. And with me today, I have Connor over at Rock Pokemon.
What's up, guys? Pleasure to be here, Rob.
What we're kind of doing today, guys, is we're doing kind of a first of hopefully many, kind of a podcast style video. We're just going to be bringing you guys some topics, and kind of what we have on the docket for today is going to be just doing a little bit of background about each other, kind of letting you guys know who we are, and you know why we're in the Pokemon hobby. We're going to talk about what we're collecting and kind of why we're collecting those things. We're going to give a little bit of our opinion here, talk about, you know, what we think is underrated and overrated in the hobby right now. And then we're going to talk about Connor's recent experience grading with CGC, kind of talk about, you know, hey, is it too tough of a grading company? Is it worth grading with them? Should we hold out for PSA? So that's kind of what's on the docket for today. And so, Connor, why don't you just start us off, man? Just give us a little bit of background about yourself.
Sure. So super stoked to be here. Thank you for having me. Super appreciate it. So my name's Connor. I'm from upstate New York, Rochester. So you can find me around the internet as Rock Pokemon, ROC, play on Rochester, New York. It's a city in upstate, pretty close to Canada. But I work in the financial services industry. So I think I've been able to kind of bring this unique perspective of someone who's like a fiduciary with my clients and bring that like financial perspective to this hobby that's really exploded and has had a lot of, I guess, monetary focus come into it, and a lot of people like potentially making bad decisions around the monetary aspects of it. So, but at the core, I'm a longtime collector. So I was an athlete my entire life. So my dad was really big into sports as well, and one of my coaches for a lot of the sports I played. And he would like get us like booster boxes of sports cards. Like I have like the I still have the box right here. It's the top set when LeBron James and Carmelo Anthony and Dwayne Wade were all rookies. So I remember him like putting hanging a Shaquille O'Neal card on the Christmas tree, like for me when I was a kid. Yeah. So yes. Really big sports family. And then I was an athlete, but I was like a nerdy chubby kid. Like I loved reading Animorphs and playing Pokemon Yellow on my Game Boy. And like my earliest memories of Pokemon are like opening Team Rocket at my grandma's house. Like, you know, I was born in 91, so was, you know, 8 or 9 years old, you know, when Pokemon was starting its heyday. So really, you know, went in and out of different collecting spheres my entire life, whether it's Pokemon or sports. I like the Peanuts. You can see it back here, the like Snoopy and Charlie Brown and stuff.
Love it.
Harry Potter, huge for me. Really, really huge fan of everything around that. It was super formative for, you know, kind of me growing up. And then I'm also a big art collector. So huge, you know, I have a certain style. You guys can see I have some art back here, and I just I really enjoy that. And I think that ties really well into, you know, why I collect Pokemon, where I view kind of every piece as a little piece of art, whether it's a sealed pack or a ETB or a card. There's something you can appreciate so much about that quality and that aesthetic. So that's me. I'm just a humble collector from upstate New York who's out here trying to grow the community and help people maybe, you know, make some better decisions with their dollars.
Absolutely. And you have a really good YouTube, and it's really impressive to see kind of, you know, how fast you've grown. I feel like that you get, you know, good viewers each video, and they're super, for me, it's just like the content that I absolutely crave. It's just, you know, one collector talking to another. You're not this massive big name. You don't have like all the experience in the world where it's just like listening to guys like SM Pratt. You're just one collector talking to other collectors, talking about, you know, how you go about things, and just, you know, tips and tricks of what you've picked up along the way to kind of help others and to bring really like this perspective of like, you know, your career into the mix. You know, you're talking about your financial advisor, and kind of taking like emotion out of the equation, really going about things with critical thinking, and you know how that is like your long-term strategy in regards to like how you enjoy this hobby, you know. And because I feel like for me, I can get very emotionally driven with Pokemon. That just brings up so many memories. And for instance, I was looking at a card earlier today, and like my first instinct was like, I want it now, you know. And I had to take a step back and be like, okay, well, it's X amount of money. How much have I spent? How much do I have for this month? And I feel like that perspective is something that, you know, doesn't get talked about a lot. You know, a lot of it is pack openings and hype and fun and new set and blah, blah, blah. And we forget to kind of like take a step back and say, like, this does cost money. You know, this is cardboard. Although it's cardboard we love and it makes us feel good, it's not necessary. So I really love watching your videos. You know, and so for anybody that hasn't gotten a chance to, you know, rock Pokemon, ROC Pokemon, great, great content to digest every single Monday for your Market Mondays.
Every Monday. I appreciate that. Yeah, I think it's, you know, a lot of people grow up not talking about money with their family. And now kind of where this hobby's come is, I think like a lot of like the big names out there, like will throw out like dollar numbers and, you know, talk about prices a lot. But like, you're right. We forget that like, just everyday people have like budgets and need to, you know, the last place you want to be is like that uncomfortable feeling of having like overspent or not be able to like live your life and enjoy the hobby within the broader, like, you know, setting of your entire life. So that's what we're trying to do. We're just trying to keep it real. I'm a person who's always appreciated having a smaller, tighter knit community. So having an engaged viewer base and an engaged, you know, group of folks on Instagram as well is really what I'm aiming for. You know, I'm not trying to be the next SM Pratt to your point or Leon Hart or anything like that. I'm just trying to keep it real. And if I can just help one person make some better decisions, it makes me stoked to be able to do that. So.
Absolutely, man. Yeah, that's awesome. And I think that people like can sense that, and that's why, you know, your channel has grown, you know, and so it's really cool. I think that you're one of the guys.
It's been a blast.
Go ahead.
It's been a blast. It's just been so fun, you know, just to, I didn't think I'd be putting myself out there like this, but it just, you know, it was a cool medium for me to, you know, convey a little bit of my skill set and a hobby that I love. So I just, you know, I lucked out, and it's just been, I'm super thankful for all the people I've gotten to connect with, including you. So it's given me a lot of good perspective, that's for sure.
Yeah. And I think people, including myself, just, you know, speaking from experiences, they get tired of the fluff. You know, it's like, you know, guys like, you know, Leon Hart, like they provide a service, and man, have they pulled in so many people into the community. Yeah. But there's a lot of YouTubers out there that it's a lot of fluff, it's a lot of hype. And after a while, like you kind of just become numb to it because there's just so much of it out there. And like in the end, I'm a 31-year-old adult, and I think like a 31-year-old adult, and I like to have fun. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. And I like watching those pack opening channels and learning about what new sets are coming out and getting excited, for sure. That's part of it. But at the end of the day, like I want to, you know, digest content, you know, similar to the way that I think, you know, a little bit more monotone, very rational, very data driven, you know, not just, you know, throwing stuff out there and hoping to those people to gain more followers and subscribers by talking about what's the latest hot topic. Like I want to follow somebody that's, you know, like you said, that's real and just kind of sharing their experience. And I think a lot of people can kind of sense that as well. So just keep doing what you're doing, brother. I think it's why that we're on this call right now. I feel like we're very kindred spirits in the way that we think about Pokemon, and just, you know, we definitely love this stuff and have a passion for it, but I feel like we have a similar mind for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think, there's that kind of group of people that have that different perspective, and, you know, those channels and the hype around it, like it's awesome for the hobby in a lot of ways, a lot of positives, brings a lot of people in. And then I'm hoping they can, you know, funnel down and stay for the long game and learn a little bit from, you know, people like yourself who put, you know, so much time and effort into like the market update videos, and, you know, people like Jake from Pokenomics, and even, you know, even SM Pratt, who always, you know, in a lot of ways keeps it real. So,
oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah. It's there's a time and a place for all of it, for sure. But I totally agree. You know, you want to be, you know, challenged a little bit, right? Think outside the box, not just be entertained, but then start to really think about, you know, what it is and why you're collecting, and what it really means to you. And hopefully be, you know, guided in a path that keeps you here for the long run. So.
Absolutely, man. And just to give you guys like a little bit of, you know, background of, you know, who I am and, you know, what kind of brought me back into the hobby. And it was Lean Heart. You know, I saw a random Lean Heart video pop up on my YouTube feed. It was about 2 years ago. And I was like, people still, you know, buy Pokemon. It's still a thing. And it was right around, I think Unified Minds was a set that was out, or Unbroken Bonds, and Hidden Fates was about to come out. And so I started looking at these rainbow rares and these full arts and these GXs. And I'm like, what's all the difference? Like, how do they know what it is? And decided to go buy a couple packs at Walmart. Ended up pulling a rainbow rare Tapu Lele out of a Guardians Rising booster pack. And I was just absolutely hooked ever since. And I instantly started gravitating towards, you know, the data side of things. I saw that, you know, I started researching graded cards and, you know, sealed product, was listening to guys like SM Pratt right off the get, TCA Gaming, ZNG Emporium, Gem Mint Pokemon, you know, and I started looking at the numbers and I said, man, you know, these cards and, you know, this cardboard is worth something. And I kind of saw this opportunity to, you know, not only potentially make some money, but have a lot of fun kind of reliving my childhood. And so it was like that perfect combination that like grabbed my attention and allowed me to pour in so much time and effort in the beginning. And in fact, I'm such a data nerd is that, you know, when I got back into the hobby, I literally filled out tabs and tabs of Google Sheets in regards to every single sealed product ever released in Pokemon, from booster boxes to booster packs. And I would list like five or six of the lowest prices on eBay at the time, because I didn't know what sold prices were. I was such a noob. And so I was jotting down in a spreadsheet, and I still have it, for like five or six different price points for every single booster box, booster packs. I even did the Japanese Watsy as well, for every single set all the way up until what it was going for now. And then I also did it for PSA 10s and PSA 9s for all of Watsy, because I was just,
that's awesome,
absolutely enamored with it. You know, it's like I wanted to know, and I needed a kind of like a point of reference. Like, you know, you got to study and work hard if you want to be great at something. And I kind of like took that same energy and kind of just put it towards Pokemon. And I just, you know, really started to fall in love with the artwork and the sets. And it's just been a ton of fun for me. And, you know, what I do professionally for a job is I'm in sales and marketing. You know, I'm a MDR manager. So I run a team of people that prospect all day. And basically our, you know, their role is to, you know, pull in more leads for our company. You know, we're in mobile advertising. And, you know, so that's a little bit of my background in regards to, you know, that sales mentality of, you know, putting in a lot of hours, putting in a lot of effort into your role if you want to be good at it. I kind of try to take that same mentality and kind of put it towards Pokemon, and it's helped me out a ton, you know. And it's been so important for me to realize how important connections are in business, and that, you know, you really have to be authentic and give your time and reach out and start, you know, conversations over LinkedIn with people if you want opportunities to happen. And I kind of noticed that I need to do this with Pokemon as well, you know? So I started an Instagram, I started a YouTube, not to like make money and like, oh, I'm just going to blow up, but I just wanted to like genuinely connect with other collectors and like start to form these relationships, because I knew that that's the only way for me to grow. You know, it's the only way for me to start to get like a presence in the hobby, I guess you can say. And it's been fun, man. You know, it's just been an absolute blast so far.
That's awesome, man. I can totally resonate with the spreadsheet nerd mentality, and also just that, you know, I've been, you know, I've done a lot of spreadsheets with like basically around like EVs of sealed packs versus the cards inside, especially around Japanese, and trying to figure that whole market out, because that's really, you know, my thing. But yeah, and then just the, like, people don't think about it, but to like be successful as like, not necessarily like monetarily, like investing in this hobby, but just as like, to be a successful collector and make great decisions, it involves like a significant amount of time studying the hobby. And that doesn't mean like just researching things you want to buy, right? It means like actually like diving deep into the historical significance of items, into the price history of items, into the scarcity and the rarity of those items, like all these things that, you know, it takes a level of work ethic, that, you know, if you have that in other areas of your life, you can apply that to this hobby to be successful. So totally resonate with that. It's absolutely, absolutely true. And, you know, the platform gives you a cool opportunity to grow as a person, right? To have conversations like this, to do things that are intellectually stimulating, and have a heck of a lot of fun doing it in a hobby that we love. So couldn't agree more. It's the best.
That's awesome, man. And just kind of speaking in general, kind of going into our next segment here, what are you collecting right now? Love to get a little bit of kind of the behind the scenes look, kind of what goes into the mind of Connor, you know, when he's scrolling eBay at 1 a.m. with a beer in his hand, and, you know, like what goes into that mind,
making bad decisions
of what you're looking for, you know?
Yeah. So, you know, obviously it fluctuates over time, depending kind of on, you know, what the market's giving you. You know, I think that broadly speaking, I'm always looking for quality deals on minty Japanese vintage booster packs, right? So anything kind of Watsy era, even into some later sets there, and things like VS and all that, but you know, generally speaking, from base through the gym series, and then even into the e-reader sets, Skyridge, and well, they're split in Japanese, but at any rate, I'm always looking for great deals there.
And that's actually how we kind of started talking, is I remember you reached out and you bought a Japanese Gym Challenge booster pack from me.
I did. And yeah. I forget you had something else. And I was like, no, that's the 300 yen version, and I want the 291. And I remember us talking about that, because there's a tax change in Japan, so the the packs started getting printed with the additional tax included into the price. So that's why you see some with 291 and then some with 300. And that matters, right? Like talking about being a student, like the 300 packs of Japanese Gym Challenge, the likelihood of those having the band cards in them is probably less, because that means they were printed later, because they had the later wrapper, which means they were probably corrected already. Like something like Koga's Ninja Trick that had like the swastika that got changed to some other symbol. But yeah, always looking for sealed Japanese vintage. I'm team sealed. Like, I think that's one of the best parts of this hobby is, you know, both as a collector, you know, I've got a ton of it here, and then also just as an investment or a store of value over time. Like, I think that it's kind of that slow and steady part of the hobby that, you know, we don't know how much is out there, but we do know as people open it, the supply does go down. Right. And that can be a bit of a trap sometimes, but at the end of the day, I think the supply demand's in your favor over the long run. And then you always have the optionality to open it and enjoy it. Right. So love sealed product. Something else I'm always looking for are the non-TCG Bandai Prism vending cards. So I actually have one right here that I just picked up, but it's an Evolutions card.
Oh, you ended up getting it, huh?
I did. I found it. Nice. Found a good deal. Yeah, I felt good about it. So I think that, you know, you got to be careful with these, because I think a lot of them are overpriced. Even ones that I've bought, I've probably paid too much for the long run, but I think that they're super unique. And really beautiful cards. There's some like hidden ones where you peeled off the front that was a non-prism and it became a prism. Like there's about a half dozen of those maybe. So I love those just because I'm such a, if the guys can't tell who are guys and gals are watching, I'm a big Japanese collector. So to a fault, that's what I
All
tend
the way.
To focus on. Yeah. And then, you know, there's things I like personally as a collector. I really like Togepi cards, Magikarp cards. I've been enjoying modern. So just trying to set aside a bit of my budget to open and enjoy the newest sets. Again, a lot of Japanese, especially because of the print quality.
Absolutely.
And then I have a handful of grails I'm chasing after. One of which in particular is a signed Himeno card. It's my favorite artist in the hobby. And I think that, you know, as a collector who really loves the art and has a true appreciation for that and has the earliest memory of pulling a Team Rocket Charmander out of a rocket pack and seeing that Himeno artwork for the first time. It's something that I think would be a really cool kind of pinnacle of the collection. So biding my time there. So I have like this mix of, you know, things that are just like what I want as a collector. And then things that I tried to find and, you know, kind of assess being under or at market that I think have the ability to appreciate over time, you know, because whether I'm collecting it or buying it as a, something I'm going to potentially sell down the road, hopefully for a higher price.
Right.
I want it to be a smart decision regardless. So, and then the last thing is, you know, outside of the Pokemon realm, I'm constantly looking for unique and interesting Harry Potter items.
Okay.
25th anniversary of the first book is next year, the Philosopher's Stone. So
I didn't know that. Wow.
Yeah. So they're doing a whole bunch of stuff next year. I've already pre-ordered like a reprint of the book that has like some cool, I think it has like additional art in it and like a cool stamp on the front or something, but,
nice.
They're doing stuff all year. And so, you know, I don't think it's like going to be something crazy like Pokemon's 25th anniversary. And obviously we've already seen like a lot of Harry Potter stuff take off with all other collectibles, but it's something I've enjoyed collecting my entire life. And I have tons of the sets of books sealed and also just like old, you know, kind of mintier copies of the books. So a goal there would be to have like a signed J.K. Rowling book as well sometime in my life.
Nice.
So yeah. So yeah, just, always looking for interesting things in that realm. There's like one particular item that I'm looking for there that pops up very rarely. So, but yeah, so that's what I'm collecting right now. Enjoying modern, going after my classic Japanese vintage and, you know, trying to accumulate even more sealed product, even though I have a ton in my safe already, or multiple safes at this point. So how about you? What are you collecting now?
Yeah, that's good. And I can definitely relate to a lot of what you're going after. And yeah, dude, my heart is in Japanese, you know, it just is. And it's so funny because I remember when I first came back into the hobby and I was looking at some of these prices for Japanese and I'm just remember thinking like, this is insanely cheap. Like, why is it so cheap? I don't understand.
Yeah.
Like, that gym challenge booster pack that I sold you initially, I got for $30.
Oh yeah.
You know,
they
what
were
mean?
So cheap. Yeah.
And I got, you know, rocket packs and jungle packs all for $30, and, you know, PSA 10 blast always from Team Rocket, $30, you know, it was just, I just didn't understand how it was this cheap. And I kind of didn't know about the Japanese market too much. And so I started taking like small risks and just buying these things. And I said, you know what? It's not a lot of money. If anything, you know, I'll just keep it because the pack art is just phenomenal. I mean, it's just
unreal.
Miles, leagues ahead of English. And so
I'm looking at two base next to each other right here. And I'm like,
oh,
man,
yeah.
What were they thinking?
Yeah. And so I remember just my thought process was, all right, it's kind of a low entry point, not huge risk. I had a fair amount of money saved up to start, you know, kind of experimenting. And I was like, at the very least, these pack arts are just totally badass and I will just love looking at them. And, you know, luckily, you know, the market did, you know, see an uptick for Japanese and it's continuing to grow. I feel like a lot more people are starting to realize that, you know, for me, I just feel so much more connected looking at a Japanese card compared to English. There's just something about it that just feels different. And even on like on a lot of these modern cards, the texture is different. Like the look is different. Yeah. The shine is different. And it just makes me feel, you know, super connected to this hobby that I love so much. And so I definitely like to collect a lot of Japanese. One of my, you know, stuff that I've been collecting lately are just gold stars.
Yes. It's great card.
Kind of tough to see with the lighting. So amazing, I think card. You know, Japanese
Crystal Guardians.
Yeah, this is on the Japanese side though. So it's a Miracle Crystal.
Miracle Crystal.
Yeah. And you know, I got that in a 10 for less than $1,000. And I just for first edition gold star, you know, vintage, where you don't really see booster packs show up that much. And if they do, they're pretty pricey, you know, for Japanese EX era. I just thought that that was a phenomenal pickup. And so I love collecting gold stars. I think to me, it's the height of Pokemon in regards to what I'm looking for as a collector. I grew up opening base jungle fossil. I love WotC, don't get me wrong, but in regards to amazing, amazing artworks for regular holos, then you have the EXs, which I'm just such, I just love them. They just look, yeah, they absolutely have my heart. Yeah. So you have that next level of chase. And then you have the gold stars, which it's like, you know, if you don't pull the EX, you have a shot at a gold star. If you don't pull the gold star and you pull an EX, at least you got that. And if you pull a holo, at least you got that. And it's like, there's just these different layers of chase for me that I really enjoy. And to me, the artwork is just, it's just phenomenal. And that kind of leads me into, you know, what else I'm collecting. And this is a Swampert. It's on the English side.
Nice.
From EX Ruby Sapphire. Yep. Yeah, it's a PSA 10. It's by Mitsuhiro Arita. And so my two favorite artists are Arita and Atsuko Nishida. Both of them are, you know, OGs to the hobby. You know, Atsuko Nishida created Pikachu, you know, made the Pikachu Illustrator card, you know, most expensive card in the hobby. And so I've been collecting artworks from them. Here's a two Nishida artworks, Roselia and Minun, from the EX era and PSA 10s. Because they're very low pop. And I just think that the artwork is just second to none. So that's kind of something that I'm just collecting for me, for my PC. I'm not looking to sell those. I'm not looking to make any money off that. And then something that I've been buying recently, again, is, you know, Japanese sealed. I just think that there's such potential upsides, you know, for that market. In fact, there's two booster boxes right there, Fossil over here, Jungle over here. That I picked up within the last, what has it been, like 2 months now, I think.
Yeah.
From our buddy Glenn. And
our buddy Glenn.
Yeah.
The man, guy the myth, the legend.
Yeah. That is
unreal.
The perfect way to describe him.
Oh, my gosh. And so a great human. Oh, what? Great human. Just a great human too. Oh. He's just a fantastic person.
Absolutely. I couldn't have asked for a better experience to meet up with somebody in person and do a deal. I was, I told him, like, I had to bring an extra shirt in the car because I was so nervous taking $20,000 worth of cash in, you know, in cash down to, you know, Spokane, which is the city for me. You know, I live in a quiet little resort town. And meeting up with somebody that I've never met. And I'm like, is this guy going to try to murder me? Like, what is, you know, what is going to happen here? And so it was just an amazing experience. Totally awesome. And for me, Japanese booster boxes are much less scarce, or they're more scarce, excuse me, than the English side. I mean, you go onto eBay right now and you type in jungle booster box and you're going to find a dozen, you know, first edition, unlimited, whatever. You try to do that for Japanese and, you know, one, maybe two comes up. If you look, I think there's no, that's for fossil. Yeah. You have one right now that's sitting at like $100,000 or something crazy like that.
That's something crazy.
And so for me, I'm all about, you know, scarcity, rarity, you know, try to follow those fundamentals that SM Pratt always talks about.
Yeah.
And I just think that they're really good long-term holds. And like you said, there's just so much you can do with it. I can keep it sealed. I could sell that box out. I could do a box break and open up some packs and kind of sell it that way. I can keep a couple for my collection because I love collecting sealed packs. So there's just a lot of different things that I can do with it. And I really like that option a lot.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I think that's super, super smart. I came very close to picking up a Japanese box this past year myself, but holding out, allocating those dollars elsewhere, and maybe we'll circle back to it someday, but enjoying the many packs I have, that's for sure. So that's awesome, man. I think that leads really well into our next segment. Things we see in the hobby that are overrated and underrated. Because one of the things that I wanted to say, so to start, is on the underrated side, I think are a lot of like the EX commons and uncommons. Like I think the artworks on those are like bang on. Like there's so many good ones that I think because of where the hobby was at that time, how much has kind of survived since then on an already kind of lower pool of print run perhaps. And also a lot of people not, you know, we're kind of in the heyday of WotC right now, right? We're in the, all of us who are around 30 years old who opened up WotC when we were, you know, kids are re-enjoying it now. And we've seen that boom, right? Everyone went into their closet and pulled out their base set. But
absolutely,
I think that, you know, we've seen people pivot to EX more, but I think that it's still like, I feel like there's a new card I see every day. I feel like it's the part of the hobby I know the least about. As far as like each individual set and the constituents and which Pokemon are in it and which artists and all of that. So obviously, you know, understanding the whole gold star phenomena and everything and the very difficult nature of pulling one of those. But I think that, you know, as far as an underrated part of the hobby, some of the, you know, like a binder set of EX, any EX set, whether, you know, you name it, obviously like Team Rocket Returns being one of the best on the English side.
I was just looking up today. It's so funny that you say that because I saw a post on Instagram. I think it was from Heavenly Hollows, and he posted a PSA 8 reverse holo from Team Rocket Returns of Weezing. And Weezing is not the Pokemon that people like want to collect or like go nuts for, but I saw this artwork and it just blew my mind. And it was one of those times where like I got right off of Instagram and I went straight to eBay and I was like, what is available for this card? Because it is so dang cool, you know? And like, I just feel like the EX era is just filled with those moments that I've had recently. And it gets me excited about collecting again. Cause you're right. There's just so many cool, unique arts. And for me, it just has everything.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I just picked up a binder recently at a flea market that had a ton of EX era cards in it.
Oh, nice.
And it was very cool. To go through that binder and see all the artworks. It was just super unique. It was a lot of cards I hadn't ever seen in person, much less, you know, many of them seen at all. So very cool. So how about you? What's something you think that's underrated in the hobby right now?
So should we do underrated first and then go to, and then we'll do overrated, or do you want
to do overrated? Yeah, why don't we do that? No, you do an underrated one and we'll see.
All right. So absolutely first edition base in Shadowless. And that's going to sound really vague and very broad. So let me give you guys some kind of concrete numbers here that I pulled off of eBay. And as I'm pulling these numbers, I'm just scratching my head, asking myself, how is this possible? How are the first set ever to come out at the price points that they are? And so for me specifically, what I think is for first edition base are the lower end grades. So anything below a 9. And what I kind of want to focus on today is like the 7s and 8s, because, you know, the 4 through 6s are just, they're criminal right now. It's insane how affordable they are. But the 7s and 8s are still, you know, technically that near mint to mint card. And so as a collector, I want to buy something that isn't completely just hacked and, oh, I have the card, but I can, you know, barely see it because there's so many scratches on the hollow, or there's so much whitening, or it's so off-centered where it just doesn't have that same eye appeal. Yep. Which is what I tend to collect, you know, cards that look good, you know?
Yep.
And so
that's going to become,
it's
going to become huge in this hobby. I mean, it's always been like that in the sports world. Like, eye appeal has been a huge thing. Mm-hmm. It's becoming more and more of a thing, I think, in the Pokemon world for sure. Yeah. So totally agree with that aspect. Yeah. Continue. Sorry.
Oh no, man. It's, I couldn't agree more. In fact, it's so funny. Cause like, I think like a month or two ago, like the CEO or, you know, the president of PSA was talking about how important eye appeal is to collectors. And it made me realize like, oh, that's why swirls are more, you know, because like,
yes, it
looks good. Like, people
swirls get girls.
They chase that.
I got to show, I did, I replaced, a piece of my big three. And, so I had a Blastoise before and I sold it, but I picked up a new one and the camera can't probably capture it, but man, does it have a good swirl on the edge.
Can you point to it?
It's on this side right here.
Okay.
I can kind of capture it. I know it's hard. It's a good one in person, man. You can kind of see it when it hits there, but yeah, man, that eye appeal part, if it's got decent centering and it's got a nice swirl, the back can look like heck for all I care. So.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes it's hard to tell the difference between, an 8 and a 9 and a 9 and a 10, or even an 8 and a 10 sometimes. I mean, it's kind of crazy. Yeah. So I'm constantly looking for, cards that look good. And so for 7s and 8s for first edition base, it's kind of nuts. A couple of things that I was looking at earlier today is PSA 8 Magneton, $475 or best offer. First edition Poliwrath PSA 8, $500 or best offer. And you think about, you know, and that may be like, well, no one cares about Magneton, no one cares about Poliwrath. It's the first set ever, guys. You know, TCA Gaming right now is selling heavy packs for $20,000, and heavy packs traditionally have gone for about twice as much as what unweighed packs go for, kind of just historically speaking, not always, maybe more, maybe less at times, but historically speaking, it's usually about twice the price of an unweighed pack. And so let's just go ahead and say roughly on average, that's $10,000 a pack, 1 in 3 odds of pulling a holo. You know, there's 16 cards in base set for the holos.
Sounds about right. I know
something
that's
like
where
that. I think Zapdos is number 16. Yeah. I can't remember exactly.
I think you're right.
And so, you know, you have a 1 in 16 shot at pulling, you know, a card. Most likely it's going to be something that's not super, you know, popular, like, you know, some of the big three, or maybe like you want like Chansey or Raichu or Mewtwo or something like that. Hitmonchan, it's like really low pop, something like that. So you get one of the other, you know, 7 or 8, and it's a set that's what, you know, 20, 25 years old. It's probably not going to be in gem mint condition. Although I have noticed that first edition base set, the print quality is very good. And it kind of blows me away to see like the Logan Paul breaks, to see how many tens actually came from that break. It was kind of nuts actually. But most likely we're probably looking at 8s to 9s, you know? And so you go from this $10,000 initial price point, you decide to open it, you get lucky and you pull a holo. And then not even looking at grading fees, time, insurance, if you sell on eBay, fees, all of that. And you're looking at a price point of $475 to $500. Like,
it's a very wide delta.
Is insane.
On the EV. Yeah, it seems too wide in a lot of ways, right? So one of two things has to happen. The pack prices have to come down, or those card prices, you know, probably have to go up. There's always going to be a discount, but there should probably be more of a convergence. Yeah, that's a lot of the work I did on Japanese sealed when I was first really getting heavy into it, is understanding that discount.
Yep. And the other side of the story here that I have to remember is that you got guys like me and you that love collecting sealed and will never open these packs. And so that does add to the premium of how expensive they are. So I can't just base everything based off of like what an unweighed pack is, or, you know, the expected value of opening it. Cause some people will never open that because it's such a grail item itself as sealed. And that's why it adds to the price. But when you look at the,
couldn't pay me to open this. Like, even I don't care if I pull all three starters in a freaking Pikachu, you can pay me to open this. Right. It's probably a light, but yeah,
right.
Totally agree.
Such a beautiful pickup. You know, I love when, as soon as you sent me that picture, I was like, oh, so jealous.
Agree.
And so, you know, kind of just getting back to this, it's like, there's this huge, huge, massive difference of like opening versus sealed. Like you look at like, let's just say first edition jungle. I think TCA Gaming or not TCA, ZNG, I saw posts, I think he's doing unweighed packs for like $300 or $325.
Yeah, and sounds right.
And if you think about, you know, PSA 8s for first edition jungle for the hollows, you're probably looking anywhere between like 100 to like 150 for some of the lower end stuff, you know, things that people don't really care about. And then, you know, probably for, you know, the Snorlaxes, the Jolteons, the Vaporeons, you know, some of the bigger potential pulls, you're probably getting into like that $200 to like $450 range. I'd be surprised if any PSA 8 went for $500, but it could.
Yeah,
it could. It definitely could,
but
you know, and so when you take a look at that, like $325 and then compare it to, you know, 125, let's just say you pull the worst as compared to 10,000 to 500, you know what I mean? Like it's
right.
Such a huge gap, you know, like, and it just doesn't make sense. And you hit it on the head, man. It's like, something has to happen. Either the sealed product is going to come down, it's too expensive, or the cards have to go up. It's got to have that balance, you know? And right now I just feel like it's heavily, you know, unbalanced on the PSA side. And I talked about this, I think on our live or, you know, on another, you know, chat back and forth, I want to start a first edition PSA 8 base set collection.
Nice.
And as soon as this call is over, I'm going to get off and make my first two purchases before Let's someone go. Goes and picks up those cards that I was just talking about.
That's awesome. But, are you thinking just the hollows, or you want to do a full set? Just the hollows.
Yeah. Just the hollows. And it's going to be a long, you know, uphill battle, but I think that's something that not only I can, you know, invest in and spend my money wisely, but it's first edition base, man. I mean, it's like, I don't need to say anything more. It's just those cards, those artworks, I just resonate so well with. So it just makes sense for me. There's a lot of, you know, different things I could spend $500 on. And to me, it's and I hate saying this, no brainer, but to me, it's a very strong pull for me to be like, this is the answer. Out of all the things in Pokemon to spend money on, cause I love it all, this is like, for me, like very clear cut. So I'm really excited to add a couple of those to the collection soon.
That's awesome. Have you, when you thought about that, because you mentioned Shadowless too, how did you kind of come to the decision of, you know, should I do first edition or should I do Shadowless for, your collection?
Great question. One, I already have some Shadowless and I've never owned a first edition base set card. So I want to hold something up close in my hand. And there's just so many things that I've been able to hold luckily and sell down the line, you know, if interest change or whatever, but I'm all about like that, you know, something that's tangible that I can pick up. There's a reason why I have this display here in the background and, you know, this stuff isn't all sitting in the vault. It's because like, I love this stuff and I need to pick it up on a daily basis. I need to look at it and I need to like have that connection to it. It like keeps me going in this hobby. And it's very important for me to like, look at these cards all the time and to feel that connection, that passion that drives me. And so I want to hold, you know, first edition base in my card or in my hand. I do have some Shadowless already. So I kind of feel like I'm just kind of diversifying. You know what I mean?
Nice. Yeah, absolutely.
And it's crazy because some of the, and just to give you guys a couple of sold prices for first edition base, which is crazy, is the Blastoise and a PSA 8, $1,900. PSA 8 Venusaur, $1,300. Like, think about that. Like, those are
dropped a lot too. My goodness.
It's like two of the three cards you want to pull. And they're only going for a fraction of the price of an unweighed back. It's just, that's just mind blowing to me.
Do you know what the Charizard goes for in an 8 right now?
Yeah, it's going anywhere between 12 to 15. And not too long ago, it was going for like 9 to 10. But as of recently, it's been going from 12 to 15. Popped.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah. Interesting. It does. Yeah. I think that I talked about this in one of my videos. Like, I think the graded card market's definitely like the riskiest part of the market just because the supply side's really unknown. Mm-hmm. But the way I looked at it and seeing where we kind of sit and where we are with the PSA specifically with the complete through dates, I think we've seen a lot of the 8 and above get absorbed by what's been graded thus far. And I think that 8 area could be a pretty good sweet spot for you, because I think like that 7 below, I think there's going to be a lot of opportunity there. Like I think the 4 to 7 range, definitely more so in unlimited. But even in first edition, there'll be a lot more opportunity. But I think that the 8 and above range is going to be a lot harder, because a lot of the stuff now is the, you know, just any person who grabbed the stuff they had laying at their parents' house, and probably a lot of it's unlimited. There might be some first eds in there. I've seen a lot of collections where like 1 or 2 first eds just sneak in there somehow, but that could be a sweet spot, man. So that's awesome. That's a super cool goal too, because at the end of the day, like, you're gonna enjoy that. Like, you talking about wanting to hold a first edition base card in your hand, like that's like what this is about. And if it's like within your means to do it, then you know what, so be it, because it's going to be a process, buying, finding all the right card. Cause it's not just any 8, right? It's the 8 with the good centering, or the 8 right. with the swirl, or the Absolutely. 8 that doesn't have a print line, or the 8 where the, the dings on the back corners, like, it's, it's easy, at least now, to just pick up cards, but right. it's a lot harder to pick up the card that you want in sets where there is a decent amount in the population, but not every 8 is made the same. So that's awesome, man. That's super cool. That's a great goal. So,
yeah. And it's, and I really think that, there is a ton of opportunity in Shadowless as well. And it's just a cheaper, more viable option. And you think about it, there's not much that separates it from first edition base. It's just that stamp, but the saturation of the colors, how a lot of them are much more brighter, kind of like this lighter, they have some darker ones as well, but unlimited just looks kind of
a little different,
a little bit, blah.
The yellow's super bright. Super bright, but I don't know. I think unlimited looks the most like childish, I guess that's the right way. Like, I don't like unrefined. I mean, it's still Pokemon, but like, you know what I mean? Like, I honestly think, and I know some YouTuber just put out a big video about his PSA collection of Shadowless. I'm yet to watch. It just came out this week that he, my $200,000 investment. I think he's a Pokemon fan, but he's not a Pokemon YouTuber. I don't know who it was, but he did a video and Gary's in the video and I haven't watched it yet. But I forget his name.
Professor Oak Cali or something like that. Is that
no, not him. He was in the video too, though. I forget who it was.
I remember seeing a thumbnail about it.
Yeah. I think that he was involved. I forget. But anyway, the point is that Shadowless, a lot of when it comes down to it with Shadowless is like education, right? Yeah. So, but that might mean that it always has that barrier and it never gains the popularity it might deserve. But honestly, I've really enjoyed collecting Shadowless before first edition for my personal collection. Like, I just think it's really cool. Like, I like it a lot. I also think the spread between to what you were talking about earlier, same idea, the spread between, a PSA 9 Shadowless base set Gyarados and a PSA 9 first edition base set Shadowless Gyarados, I think that spread is way too wide. Like, it doesn't make sense to me.
I agree.
When you think about, like, we talk about Pratt all the time, but like older, rare, mint are better. Like, some of the fundamentals, like the supply side, the print run of Shadowless was, I mean, it was a mistake, right? It was basically an error. They're basically all error cards at the end of the day. So, I think there's just like, I think there's really good dynamics there for the longer term on that being a really interesting play. But I think we could go on about that forever. Maybe we should talk about something overrated and give people some pause on stuff. So do you want to start, or do you want me to go?
I can go, and I'm very curious to hear what you have to say, and I'm wondering if it's going to be the same thing. I don't know. It might be, but for me, it's just going to be these modern chase cards. You know, I think that they're so cool, and the way that Pokemon is moving, the direction that they're going, I think that as collectors, it's what we've been wanting. You know, we couldn't ask for anything better. I mean, you know, Eevee Heroes, Blue Sky Stream, and now, you know, Evolving Skies, you know, fun cards, popular Pokemon, good pull rates, you know, unique art, something that hasn't been done before, but it's not just throwing glitter on it and more rainbow and just making it more sparkly. Like, you're getting into the artwork, you're having these popular artists come back, and you know, it's just so cool, you know. And for me, I absolutely love them, and it just, like you said, I've been budgeting more money for modern to open, because I'm just like, this looks fun and I want to enjoy that experience. The problem that I see is that modern is just so, like, it's just so up in the air. Nobody knows what's going to happen. You know, it's just so, you know, new, obviously. And I'm seeing these price points for these cards, you know, doing these, you know, weekly market updates and looking at the stuff, you know, all the time, kind of keeping my ear to the ground. And it just blows me away that, you know, some people are willing to spend, you know, $1,000 on a modern chase card as compared to, you know, something more vintage, you know, that's been.
It's like you're taking crazy pills, isn't it? When you look at it, you're like, what a surprise. The first 10 that got graded the modern chase card got sold for X. And then the next week it sells for half that when the second and third one come onto the market. And it's the same over and over and over again every set. It's wild to watch. It's wild to watch.
Yeah. So. And it's one thing to be like, okay, I'm gonna set aside money for modern, and then, like, let's say you pull the big card, or you want it, I'm gonna spend, you know, $250 to send it off to PSA because I want to look at it. Like, that's fine if you want to do that. It can't happen all the time. Like, you can't be that lucky.
Yeah.
Or you'd have to be spending a crazy amount of money opening product, and maybe you have more money to kind of throw around. You know, maybe your you know, income is larger than ours, you know. And so just coming from the point of, like, somebody that doesn't have all the money in the world, somebody that works hard for their money, and like every dollar that I spend, I'm very conscious of, like, where is this going towards? To me, modern is just like, it's fun, it's awesome, it's great, it serves a purpose, but I'm not going to throw my financial dollars at it when I feel like if I am going to spend money at all in Pokemon, not just saying like every dollar I put in Pokemon is like, oh, I'm investing. But again, every single dollar, like, I want to be smart about that. You know, I really want to like come from that critical thinking of like, well, I could spend it on this or I could spend it on that. What are the pros and cons? Let's look at this stuff from, you know, from that standpoint, take the emotion out of it. Cause if it was all emotion, I'd be buying modern left and right. Cause it just, some of the artworks look way better than WotC. I mean,
they're unreal.
It's
they're
crazy, unreal. You know,
and that's what, like, I've said this before in videos and podcasts and stuff, like, I have tried to discipline myself and have been successful thus far to, like, I will wait 5 years to get the modern card I want, because I'm not, like, I will not buy modern singles. Like, I think it's crazy. Like, honestly, candidly, like, I went to Chicago for July 4th and I pulled that alt art Galarian Moltres from, Battle Styles, right? Right. Sold it immediately. Like, I was like,
was it that or Chilling Rain?
Was it Chilling Rain? Chilling Rain. Chilling Rain. Yeah. The,
was it Japanese or English? Style?
No, it was English.
Okay. Then I'm pretty sure it's Chilling Rain.
Chilling Rain. Yeah. It all blends together right now. Sometimes I'm like, what set are we on? Like, how?
Yeah.
I went to Target today. I'm like, how are the, I don't even remember where we are, but yeah. So Evolving Skies is now. So, yeah, it was from Chilling Rain. And, I was just like, I'm uncomfortable with how much this card is worth when it just got printed last week. So, yeah, totally hear you there. Can't disagree. Moderns, you know, I would rather, like, I look at the money I spend on modern as like entertainment, like yep. Same thing as going to the movies.
Absolutely.
$20 at the movies or $20 on half a dozen, you know, Evolving Skies packs, like same difference, right? You know, and it's fun and you can make content around it too. And it's super enjoyable. You know, I love opening packs with like friends too. It's really neat. And seeing them like start to enjoy like random TCGs and all that. That's one thing I didn't mention. I like to collect other, just open other TCGs. But anyway, it's just entertainment for me. Like there are a couple modern, I talk about the Crimson Invasion Rainbow Gyarados all the time. Like I love that card, but I still refuse to pay for it. Was there anything else you wanted to mention on modern? Cause it ties to what I'm say for sure.
Yeah. I think that like, I can go on for a bit about this because, you know, like I said, it's just so much fun and it's enjoyable. And I see people that like post modern stuff. And I'm just like, man, I want that card, you know? But then the bigger side of my next thought that follows is I'll be patient. I'll play the long game, you know? And like you said, I am willing to wait, you know, 3, 4, 5 years, whatever, to get these cards. Cause I just feel like if we, you know, follow any type of, you know, pattern, as history has shown us, is that, you know, modern comes down in price. It just does, you know, people get excited about, you know, the newest set, what's going out, and it reaches this point where it kind of comes down. What's going to be interesting is that, you know, certain cards like on the Japanese side, which are much more harder to pull, like these alternate arts or the VMAX alternate arts, they're tough to pull. I think I heard SM Pratt talk about, he opened an entire case of EV Heroes and didn't pull one alternate art. That's crazy. That's like that gold star status of chase and hard to pull. And that's fun. And that's really cool to go after too, but it's just too early for me to tell, like, will these like have a place in Pokemon 10 years down the line? Like, are they going to hold its value? Or, I mean, are they going to go, you know, up even more because so many people want them still? I just don't know. There's too many variables for me to like risk my money putting that in right now. And if, time has taught us anything, you know, over this last year when we saw Pokemon just reach astronomical prices so dang fast, I remember thinking like, it's never gonna stop, like it just keeps going up, I gotta buy this now, like that fear of missing out. And then it just absolutely falls off a cliff, retraces, you know, we have to come back down to earth and be realistic, have to follow those fundamentals. It's a lot harder to make money in Pokemon. You can't just buy something now and a month later it's selling for double. It stopped working that way. And so like it's just really cool to like come back down to that, because it's just unrealistic for the longest time. Yeah. I think a lot of people that were coming into Pokemon, like new collectors or you know, coming over from sports or whatnot, they were buying into the hype and then it like started slowly going off. And then like people are like panicking, you know, and they were spending way too much money on this stuff. And so for me, I just don't know what's going to happen. It's just too risky for me to continue to like shell out money. Cause I mean, there's a new chase card every single day and they all look awesome and they all look great. But at the end of the day, like I can't catch them all, you know, like I can't.
That inherently is the problem too, is that these alt arts are amazing, but there are a lot of them.
Yeah, exactly.
Both in variety and then obviously like the print runs are quite large. And look, I'm willing to be wrong about this because if I see a card $100 today and I think I should be able to buy it for $20 and it goes to $250 in 2 years, I'm willing to be wrong on that. And then I'll just decide which one instead of three that I really want that much.
Right.
And even then, like you might not even buy it. Like, I think it's a good test of like patience and being prudent and like being okay with your thesis playing out against you. Because at the end of the day, like, collecting should be about, like, I don't think collecting is just accumulating things. It's collecting individual items that you truly love and enjoy.
Right.
And if you have too many of them and just keep buying up every new right. modern hit that comes out, like how can you even have time to look at them all? Right. You know, to your point earlier, like, I want to be looking, like, I love having this stuff in my, yeah. I love working from home 3 days a week. So I get to look at my collection all day long. I mean, I've got that Himeno Charmander card in front of my computer screen over there, you know? So, mm-hmm. Yeah, look, I think for my, we could talk about modern, and I think we will talk about modern yeah. in a future conversation.
Oh, definitely.
And a lot of the dynamics around it. I think for me, it plays into that, and it's certain parts of the graded market. And I think one thing I want to touch on is, like, graded commons and uncommons. I think that there's this super weird dynamic in the market right now where there's, by sellers, there is this perceived value of their cards based on the fact that you can't grade at PSA, basically. Mm-hmm. And even at CGC, you know, it's at least, you know, with subgrades, whatever, $25 a card or whatever, right? And the, mm-hmm. you know, it's going to take a year. Right. So there's this idea of that somehow putting this, like, floor in on value for cards. Now there's some sellers who, you know, they graded a card and all in cost them $7. So they're willing to sell you that card at 20. And that's awesome.
Right.
But there's modern cards, and then there's also vintage singles, especially in unlimited land, which I just don't really touch unlimited. I think that there's a place for PSA 10 holos for some of them, because they're, you know, collectible investor on Instagram, great guy, huge unlimited collector, and has really taught me a lot from observing him and then actually looking at pops that I shouldn't just throw all unlimited out in the trash, like, especially when you get into the Neo sets, because they were sometimes printed concurrently. But all that to be said, there are a lot of, like, commons and uncommons that I think, again, it's that waiting game of seeing how, like, the populations flesh out.
Right.
And then the same thing with some modern graded cards, where I'm like, look, this CGC 9, like, one I really like is the, was it the Small But Mighty collection, that, that alternate art that came in that pin box. And it also was in Japanese in Tag Team GX. It's the one with Cleffa and Igglybuff and Togepi on it.
Yeah,
I love Togepi, and they're, like, surrounded by all the cool stuff.
Yep.
There's the other one, there's the rainbow where they're, like, angry, but then there's, like, that cool one where they're all, like, surrounded by Pokeballs and stuff. Like,
great artwork.
Like, I see a bunch of people, like, unreal artwork.
Yeah.
I see a bunch of people listening for 50, 55, 65, and, like, I'm willing to throw a $20 low ball in and see if someone comes back with 25, but, like, I'm just not gonna pay $50 for that or $60 for that. Like, I think that is silly right now, and it's an overrated part of the hobby, is picking those up right now. So mm-hmm. I think people would get mad if I had just said I think Charizard's overrated and then said nothing else, so I decided to go this route instead. Don't hate me, guys, but Charizard's overrated. Gyarados is better. Anyway, yeah, I've bought, you know, stuff, and it's more for my, like, collection. Like, I bought this, like, CGC 9, this Totodile from Neo Destiny.
Beautiful.
Like, I think this is, the artwork on this is so sick. Like, it just makes me smile whenever I look at it. Right. And, like, I think I paid $23 for this. And I was
yeah.
like, okay, that's yep. okay. But I'm not going to pay $50 for this. Because, right. like, it's just, I think there's too many of them. And I think that, you know, especially as stuff keeps getting broken, you know, people are, you know, packs are ripped and people are just going to grade everything, right?
Exactly.
I think that that's going to lead to, you know, there being a lot more of those. And I think that, you know, when the CGC said by the end of the year, they're going to have, they call them census, but the pop reports should be out. And I'm really interested to see what happens when we get that info and we start to, you know, merge that together with the PSA pops and some of these, because there's some things where you look it up and you're like that alt art that I just mentioned, right? The PSA pop is pretty low, but I'm like, well, this is a 2019 set and like people just weren't great. Like people weren't grading it, right? So everyone I'm seeing come up is CGC. So you tell me, what do you think that pop's going to look like? You know, if there's 100 at PSA, there's probably 500 already at CGC. So all that to be said is I think that area of the graded card market, both a lot of modern and then a lot of kind of your common Watsy era cards, you know, maybe less so into the E-series area, but I think that's a dangerous, little bit overrated part of the market right now. People are buying too much there. So
I couldn't agree more, man. I mean, something that I want to come out from like a different perspective is like each card has its own personality. Each card is unique. It has its own, you know, artwork. And like you said, that toted out, it like evokes an emotion in you that you feel connected to that. And like, I'm all for that. I mean, there's some non-holos that I just think look leagues ahead of, you know, regular holos from that set, you know, Neo Destiny in particular, like
it's unreal. The Jolteon.
The Jolteon and the Togepi.
With Togepi, I mean, and Rattata in the back.
It's crazy, you know? And I mean, even like the, not the Cyndaquil, but the next one up.
I forget the middle one.
Me too. Cyndaquil and Typhlosion. And then the middle one. Anyways, he's like,
Q?
What?
Is it with a Q?
I can't remember, but he's doing like, Quilava.
Yeah, Quilava. Yeah.
And, you know, the artwork for Neo Destiny is he's doing like Fire Spin or something like that. And like, it's just a stunning card, you know, and it's amazing. And I think that these cards are unique and they feel good. And like, I think that they have a place in Pokemon, but to also remember for like, you know, that's Neo Destiny or even like E-series can be a little bit higher in regards to the price points because there's just not as much out there. It wasn't as printed.
Yeah.
But when I covered that first edition PSA Pikachu in my market update like 2 weeks ago and they were selling for $100, a PSA 8, it's not even a Gen Mint 10. And you're looking at $100 for a card that was printed into oblivion.
I know.
Like it blows me away that somebody would be willing to pay for that price point for that card. And so I totally agree that they're beautiful and they're awesome. And I want to appreciate like everything, not just like the holos or even like you said, just the Charizards, because there's just so much more to Pokemon than that. You know, I really haven't been collecting a lot of Charizards lately because there's just so much more to Pokemon that I've been able to enjoy. But at the same time, man, like you got to use your brain. It just blows me away that somebody would be willing to spend, you know, X amount of dollars on these, you know, common, uncommon cards that have hundreds of thousands, if not millions of copies that have been printed.
Yeah, that have been printed. And then to your point earlier, that they'll spend even more on a modern card that probably will have even more printed is.
Yeah.
And in Gem Mint condition, because it went from pack to sleeve to card saver straight to a grading company. Mm-hmm. It's wild. In the same way, there's certain times where if I see a vintage card in a 9 or a 10 below a certain price point, I'm just going to buy it.
Absolutely.
So sometimes on the flip side, I'm just like, hey, vintage 9 plus holo Japanese for $40, I'm probably going to buy that.
Right.
I don't know if I can help myself.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. That's phenomenal.
Fantastic.
Anything else you kind of wanted to touch on your side for overrated?
No, I had a list for both. And I think we each hit a good one. I think that was a a good discussion. I think people start to think a little more about some of the decisions they're making, and hopefully they can find their own underrated areas to run after.
Yeah. And I'm sure that most of the people that are listening, if anybody stuck around this long, we appreciate you. Hopefully you're just
definitely
listening
do.
To this while you're, you know, doing laundry or doing some yard work, or like me sitting behind a computer all day. I love listening to content that I don't have to look at and I can just listen to and just, you know, just hang out and relax. And, you know, hopefully you guys are doing the same.
Yeah, no one wants to look at our ugly mugs. They just want to hear my nasally voice. That's all they want.
Dude, we just need to like move our heads so that we could just have our backgrounds in the back.
Yeah, you know, seriously. I just need to look zoom at that. In. I just put this car in front of my face the whole time.
Yeah. And oh, so, man. You know, hopefully that you guys have just like been enjoying it. I think we've kind of hit that hour mark, which I think we're going to kind of try to keep these, you know, podcast style type of videos too, you know, somewhere around that 45 to hour mark. I know that there was one more topic to kind of touch on. And so maybe we'll just table that for the next time. And, you know, we're not too sure, guys, if we're going to be doing this, you know, once a week, once a month, you know, whatever. I think it's just going to be about, you know, feedback from you guys if you like this stuff. So if you do, please drop a like, drop a comment. Let us know if you enjoyed this type of style of video, or if you like, dude, both of you guys suck, stop doing this, you know, let us know. We appreciate the honesty. And, I think that, it's just, we're just going to have fun with it, and we don't want to, you know, put any pressure or anything along those lines. So we do appreciate you guys sticking around, hanging out. Again, make sure that you guys go check out, you know, Connor over at Rock Pokemon on his YouTube. I'll obviously, you know, he'll have this up on his channel. I'll have it up on my channel. We'll put links below for each other's channels, support each other, Instagram, all that type of good stuff. But, Connor's just obviously just, he's one of those guys that you want to connect with. Good dude, you know, down to earth, friendly, and he's willing to have a conversation with you. So he has some good experience, some good knowledge. And if any of you guys want to reach out to either one of us on Instagram, feel free to just go ahead and do that. And, yeah, any last words, Connor, that you kind of want to say?
Hey, I appreciate the kind words. It's been such a pleasure getting to connect with you. I really appreciate, you know, your viewers sticking around with us and listening in. And yeah, like Rob said, I'm first and foremost, the reason I started this platform was to engage with people and to create, you know, community and to build that. So please comment, reach out with questions. I answer all my DMs. Like, I am a normal dude who, like, I'll get back to you after work or when I'm taking a break. Like, it's not going to be weeks. Like, I'm nobody. So love talking to folks. Any questions you have, any way we can help you, just it's, you know, it's a big reason that we're doing this. Because, you know, the relationships you build in this hobby really mean more than any of the things that we're collecting. So just appreciate it so much. And yeah, if you stumble across this video and you're not subscribed to Rob, Red or Blue, I don't know what you're doing. Please go subscribe and like and hit the notification bell and do all those things. And yeah, tell us in the comments below if we suck or you like this. So that'll let us know what happens next. So appreciate it so much, man. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, definitely, man. I appreciate you. And this is going to be fun. And just, you know, to everybody, I guess something we should have said in the beginning is that, you know, both Connor and I are not professionals. Hopefully that everything that you hear today is just, you know, understood as our personal, you know, opinion, as well as just our experience that we're sharing with people. This isn't financial advice. We're not telling you to go and do anything along these lines. We're just two regular guys, you know, talking Pokemon and having fun. So if you guys like this type of content, you guys know what button to hit. We appreciate you coming together, hanging out with us, and there will be, you know, some more content for sure. So thank you guys so much for sticking with us for our first episode. And here's to many more to come.
Yes, sir. Collect what you love, guys. Be good.